And welcome to the Threeee is a new two podcast with your host Brian Swaw and co-host Greg German from Illinois Wrestling Blog. I'm not letting you get away with it, Greg. The pen is no longer mightier than the sword when it comes to our weekly podcast, and we have it all for you this week. We have the dual breakdown, Michigan State, Spartans come to town on Military Appreciation Day, and the Soldiers Salute. Looking forward to that breakdown. But that's not all. We always have that Illini guest, the Illini Roots. And who's it going to be this week, Greg? I'm telling you, it's one of your favorites. It's the California kid. Jesse Delgado is going to be our guest. We're going to talk about Jesse, back-to-back national championships, the Scramble King. And my guy, Greg, has a bunch of clips for Jesse to break down. I'm looking forward to it, Greg. It should be a great podcast. And like always, Threeee is the new two podcast. But I have something special in store for all the Illini fans. And we're going to find out who's watching this week, Greg. Come Friday night. You know how everyone says Threeee instead of two? Well, listen to me. You see what this is? Threeee, right? One, two, Threeee. But I'm going to tell everyone this week. You know what this is? ILL. ILL. So instead of yelling Threeee on takedowns for Military Appreciation Day, I'd love to hear the crowd say ILL and get that response of INI. We'll see who's paying attention, Greg. We're going to try to do a little promotion. I'm tired of seeing the big O for Ohio State and the crazy Hawkeye fans. We're going to start a new trend at State Farm Center. Not Threeee anymore, folks. ILL for all the takedowns. We'll see if it takes, and we'll see if we have something rolling. But we're going to get rolling right now with that breakdown of Michigan State and Illini. Let's hear what you got in store for us, Greg.
Starting at 125, we've got Justin Cardani, number 79, according to WrestleStat, versus number 43, Tristan Lujan. Now, Cardani's 2-0 lifetime against Lujan, but WrestleStat is picking the Spartan to win in this match. And that's because Lujan has been kind of on the bounce while Cardani's had his hard time later this season. The Illini really, really need this win in order to win the duel, though. What do you say, Brian?
Yeah, you know, I got a chance to talk to Coach Bud about Justin's struggles, and it's evident, right? We need Justin back on track. The Illini need the senior leadership at that 125-pound mark, and what better way to get back on track than an opponent that you have beaten twice in the past? Now, here's the secret. Our guest, Jesse Delgado, has been working with Justin Cardani, been showing him a secret sauce Delgado scramble finish, and I'm hoping to see it this week. You know, Coach Puetta was very confident Justin's going to get back on track, and it's exactly what the Illini need to get this duel started going in the right direction, rolling into that 133-pound match. And another guy that's been struggling, Tony Magical. How do you see that match going, Greg?
Yeah, well, this one, he's going to come through for us. It's number 54, Tony Magical, versus number 186, Andrew Hampton. Now, WrestleStat.com is going to say that this is going to be a major decision. This should be a tech fall or pin for Tony. He's got the tilts. He's got the moves. He can beat this kid at neutral. So I'm looking for the Illini to score big points here, and they'll need big points to capture the duel.
Yeah, I mean, Hampton comes in, you said, 4-16, a weak link for Michigan State's lineup, a younger opponent. But Magical needs to use that senior leadership and veteran presence to get the Illini rolling to a 2-0 start. He needs to get back to being dominant on top. He had a very competitive match against Shriver until the third period against Iowa, right? He was right there. He was doing Tony Magical things. So, you know, that's what we need to see. We need to say Magical, Magical, Magical on Friday. Get that tilt rolling. Maybe get a back point, get some shoulders on the mat and a quick pin, and get the Illini off to a 9-0 start. Would be a great way to roll into 141. And I got some news for you. Your boy's back. Danny Pacino's back, okay? And this is going to be a nice matchup for Danny P.
Yeah, this might be one of the marquee matchups. You've got Danny Pacino, who's at number 39, versus number 24, Jordan Hamden. And Hamden, he's had a pretty good season. He's undersized, though, for 141, so Danny's not going to get pushed around. And they both wrestled well at the Midlands, although they didn't face each other. Pacino finished fourth, while Hamden finished fifth. So this is going to be not only a marquee matchup, but it should be an interesting and fun one as well.
Yeah, Hamden's grown into the role. I mean, he is undersized, but, you know, he was traveled. He was in Michigan, Michigan State. He wrestled in Illinois, in high school, traveled out to Michigan, has some history, you know, with the Illini. This is a match that Danny Pacino needs to get that home crowd rolling at State Farm Center, right? Danny needs to get back on track. He's 16-6 and 9-2 in duels, Hamden is. So Michigan State's looking at this matchup and saying, hey, are we gonna see Danny? Who's gonna wrestle here? We see the freshman Basinger made his debut, was a surprise to both of us. But Will held his own against Brody Teske. The future is bright for the Illini, right? Will Basinger, the fifth freshman to make a debut, but getting that veteran back, Danny Pacino. I see the duel starts at 125. I see a win, and I see another win here for Danny Pacino. And now the Illini are up 12-0, Greg. Let's hope we keep rolling. And 149, who's it going to be at 49? Are we going to see the freshman, Cannon Webster, who's been on a roll, 7-1 against ranked opponents? And your deli guy, you like to call him, Mr. Webster.
Yeah. Well, we've got the number 9 guy, Cannon Webster, according to WrestleStat. And he would face the number 156, Braden Stauffenberg, and they're calling for big points for the Illini in this match. And I can see it because Cannon has just been so strong, very difficult to take down, and he scored points whenever he wants to. What do you see, Brian?
Yeah, I mean, there's a chance that we see Jay Carrier. Cannon's on that verge of redshirting, not redshirting. He's been on a roll, like I said, 7-1 against ranked opponents. Here's a crazy stat for you. Braden Stauffenberg and Cannon Webster wrestled in the midget state finals back years ago in the old IKWF days. So this is a rematch. You know what? I'm sorry. The Bantam state finals. You know, so are we going to see that matchup again? Braden's been struggling. He's a redshirt freshman. He's a scrapper, though, right? He's a guy that throws hands. He's a Greco kid. You don't want to go upper body with Braden Stauffenberg. If it's Webster, like you said, should be bonus points. If it's Harrier, it'll be a dogfight, you know. But if we're looking at this properly and the duel starts at 125, and I believe that's where Coach Pueta and his staff want to see the duel start at, it could be a 4-0 roll, and we're looking at a 15-0 lead against the newly ranked 25th Michigan State Spartans as we roll in to the 157-pound match with their best wrestler coming on the mat, the next two weights here. But this is their guy that's going to give us the most trouble here, Greg. Joe Roberts and Chase Saldati.
Yeah, we've got number 74, Joe Roberts, versus number 21, Chase Saldati. And the problem with Saldati is that he likes to pin. He's had 8 pins already this year, and that tracks with his previous years. He's just been a pinning machine. So what the Illini need to do here is control him, keep good position, and stay away from the funky stuff, because Chase Saldati will exploit that and will score 6 for his team.
Yeah, 17-4, 9-1 in duels. Like you said, you know, he's a tough kid. Joe has been struggling as of late. When I spoke to Coach Pueta about Joe's struggles, you know, he said, hey, you know, I've seen this so many times. The first month of the season, Joe looked like someone that could be an All-American, right? He was beat Central Michigan, had some really good matches, won some close matches in overtime, you know, just looked fantastic. And then, you know, he rolled into the Missouri duel against Brock Mahler, who's, you know, fourth in the country. And Joe hasn't recovered from that loss. But, you know, Joe needs to get back on track, and he needs to do, you know, the odds are stacked against him in this match. But what Joe needs to do is what every coach wants to, go out there and compete, throw hands, and stay competitive against a much higherly ranked opponent, and do what you need to do to keep the duel in perspective. Especially if the Illini get off to a 4-0 roll in matches, you know, you can't have the tide turn here with the Chase Saldati pin rolling in, you know, to 165 with Caleb Fish. You know, you got Caleb Fish and the youngster, Chris Moore. You know, this is where the Michigan State kind of stacked their studs, right? You know, how do you see 165, Greg?
Yeah, Chris Moore's at number 41, Caleb Fish at number 11. And Fish has really been coming on. He's been to the NCAAs, and he's actually wrestled better lately than he did early in the season. These two met at Midlands, and it was Fish who came away with the 1-point win. And by 1 point, I mean 1 point. The score was 1-0 Fish over Moore. So I expect that Chris Moore has felt him. He knows what to expect. this is going to be a battle, and it'll be a great handshake war too, because Chris Moore has that superior handshake.
Yeah, like you said, Caleb Fish, 18-6. You know, that was a 1-point match, but WrestleStat has Fish as a heavy favorite. You know, Chris is in a similar situation as Joe is, right? This is a match where it can't get out of hand. It has to stay close. Chris has done a great job wrestling very close matches in the first period, right? Frustrating better opponents. And that's what we need to see from Chris. And Chris has great defense, but Chris needs to get, you know, not only have good defense, get in on some shots, you know, threaten Fish a little bit. So then that way the score doesn't get out of hand. But these are two matches that, you know, Michigan State are heavily favorites. If they can come out of this, Illini can come out of these without two bonus points win here, I believe that's a win at 157 and 165. While we roll into 174, and your guy needs to get back on track here. Let's hear it, Greg.
Yeah, we got number 9, Edmund Ruth, versus number 85, DJ Shannon. And that name is familiar to Illini fans. He spent 2 years starting for us. Now, he's had some hard times over at Michigan State, and his record is, let's see.
It's 9-13.
9-13. He's not having a very good year. And Edmund has, although he's not had the same stellar year he had last year. But this is one where the Illini expect to score bonus points, and I think Edmund's going to do that.
Yeah, this is a matchup that I think falls right into the hands of what Edmund Ruth wants to do. The more aggressive you get with Edmund, the more aggressive Edmund gets. And that's what we need to see. You know, when we talked to Coach a few weeks ago, he said, hey, when Edmund shoots or gets into double unders, it's 100% success rate. Kennedy, who frustrated Edmund, stood in front of him, didn't get aggressive. Shannon is known for highlight reel takedowns. He struggled in a record, but he's going to come after Edmund, and that's going to play right into Ruth's favor. I have a story to tell you here with Edmund Ruth. You know, you always say he's a workout warrior, he's putting all that work. Well, he was, as Coach said, somewhat embarrassed of the Kennedy loss, and losing to a guy like Kennedy, you shouldn't be, but in front of the home crowd, he didn't feel good. He went right upstairs and worked out, and then Saturday they had a recovery day, but Edmund wasn't having any of it. Edmund went right in the room, grabbed a couple guys, and put a full workout in. So he's looking to get back on track and get a State Farm Center against an old Illini guy, and they need this win so the tide starts turning back in the Illini favor as we roll into 184 and a familiar face back in the lineup last week for the Illini, Dylan Connell, Greg.
Yeah, number 51, Dylan Connell versus number 17, Lane Malczewski. I think I pronounced that right.
Yeah. But
Malczewski is a shifty fellow for a big guy. You can tell he wrestled at lower weights when he was younger. He likes all the funk. He likes all the shifty pinning combinations. But this was a match that we saw last year at the duel. And Connell lost this 0-2, which was a great showing for a redshirt freshman. Now, they both had pretty tough times at Midlands, and they both have been injured this year. So who's got the gas tank? Certainly the Spartan's going to be favored, but, you know, we hope that Dylan's gas tank is back and that gets him over the hump here.
Yeah, getting Dylan back in the lineup's a big boost for the Illini. You know, with such a young team, Dylan's veteran presence, it's funny saying that, Dylan's veteran presence, right? He's only a redshirt sophomore, but, you know, this team is so young and getting Dylan back is huge. I'm not sure how Megaludis is ranked 17th in the country with a 7-5 record. You know, so to me, this is a toss-up match. This is a match that, you know, the home crowd needs to help Connell pull through. And Dylan looked really good doing what he does best. And what Dylan does best is he's really dominant and physical on top. And I'd like to see that in that last match against Iowa, against Aiden Riggins, who, yeah, maybe Riggins was one of the weaker links in Iowa's lineup, but the kid was a 3-time state champ in Iowa, which, you know, so Dylan went out there and punished him, made him pay for it. And that's what we need to see from Dylan Connell, because as you know, Greg, the 197 and heavyweight weights for the Illini have new faces and injuries. So 197 and heavyweight are going to be tough matches for the Illini.
Yeah. I mean, right now, I guess social media indicated that it would be Isaiah Pettigrew number 60 versus number 51, Carl Whistler. The thing is, you don't know if Pettigrew has got a full gas tank, if he's able to perform. He was out and he missed the Iowa duel and would have been very useful there. I would see if Pettigrew's in the lineup, I can see this being a kind of a toss-up here because we haven't seen what Pettigrew can do. As long as he's healthy, he's got his gas tank at full. This is a toss-up. If he can't make it, then we've got a long laundry list of Illini who can step in. Peter Marinopoulos, Joey Bronigan, Chase Wagoner, just a bunch of guys. What do you see?
Yeah, it's going to be Joey Bronigal. It's Military Appreciation Day, Soldier Salute. He's in the ROTC, a long history of a family military. They put his face on the promo. I was told for sure that he's wrestling. I'm making that guess, right? And I think it's going to be Joey Bronigal. And, you know, he's a Cale Whistler, 23-10. You know, he's ranked 31 by the coaches poll. And so, you know, this is a match where, you know, you're going into those last two matches. You want to have a substantial lead rolling into these two matches, not taking anything away from Bronigal and possibly Marinopoulos at heavyweight, but they are going to be very, very heavily underdogs in those two matches. So, you know, this is one of those things as you coach duels where you go out there and say, hey, you need to fight, you need to scrap, and you need to do everything you can to make sure that we don't get into attack or pin situation and take one for the team. And Joey Bronigal showed some fight in that 197-pound match. He was clearly, you know, the lower-ranked wrestler and in a tough situation making his debut this year. But, you know, it's military night. Full salute for Joey Bronigal. Let's see what he can do against Cale Whistler. But this is a match Michigan State expecting bonus points on, and let's hope they don't get it. But I'm hoping to be rolling into a 6 or 8 point lead into this heavyweight match. And we're going to see Peter Marinopoulos. He looks like he has the spot now with Luke Luckman out and Richard Rue out of the lineup. So I think it's going to be Peter once again.
Yeah. And he's at number 151 because he's a freshman trying to make a true freshman trying to make his way up the rankings. And he's facing number 44, Josh Terrell. And I've watched some video on Terrell. He's not completely full size heavyweight, but he's going to outweigh anybody we can put out there by quite a bit. In fact, WrestleStat had Terrell beating Luffman, which I thought was complete BS. But Peter, if he can get his double legs going and he can stay from not get stuck under this guy, we could have some fireworks. But he has to avoid giving up the big points.
Yeah, that's the key, right? Peter's undersized, you know, he's barely tipping the scales at 215, 220, you know, so he's undersized, but can use his quickness, you know, and do not get underneath the big man, right? And that's the key. Clearly, Michigan State has an advantage here, but, you know, let's hope that Bronigal and Marinopoulos, you know, and maybe coach looks at this and says, hey, I don't want to end this duel with these two weight classes. Now, Michigan State will have the choice. Maybe that's where they want to end. Maybe that's where they want to start. But it'll be key because, you know, I have this duel right now, 5-5, possibly 6-4, depending on if we see Webster, you know, how that match rolls out. But, you know, this is going to be a toss-up duel and be a great way to knock off the newly ranked number 25 Michigan State Spartans by a few points here, Greg. And I believe they can do it. And I'm looking forward to the Illini getting back on track at the State Farm Center. Last week, we brought you Steve Marinetti, the 1995 national champ. But we're going to do you one better. No offense, coach, but we got the back-to-back national champion. The California kid, the king of funk, the guy that made scrambling cool before it was cool. Jesse Delgado, welcome to the Threeee is Two podcast. And we're going to turn it over to Greg German to start us off. But he has a very important question that all our podcast guests have to answer first.
Jesse, nice to talk to you. It's an honor. Can you tell us what you think of the 3-point takedown?
It makes sense, right? Reward the guy, the offensive guy that's scoring takedowns. It's just, it's hard to get past that. You can't say two anymore.
Yeah.
Well, we talked to Steve, right? And he was like, he said he was a real proponent of it. He was out there voting on it. And then he started doing some math. He's like, I would have scored 21 points in that national title match. So back to thinking your match, how about, you know, just think about, hey, those couple of first takedowns, it had been 6-1, but we're going to go over them. But Jesse, before we roll into those clips, you have to show us what – you got to show us your three takedown. I need to see those three fingers. Let's see the three.
I think I go like this, right? Is that normal?
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. You know, like Zane Richards gave us the international three. There you go.
Zane goes like this?
Yeah. It's whatever you do. Wait. That's what we're looking
for. Zane does this.
Yeah, international.
Oh, three.
Yeah.
He doesn't do that. He's just trying to be cool.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we're going to turn it over to Greg. We got some important clips to go over, Jesse. And thanks for being a part of the show. We're honored to have you. Back-to-back national champ, first time in 50-plus years in Illinois. You know, and to have you on this broadcast is just awesome. You know, you came from California, went to Illinois, and now you're back in Illinois. But, Greg, you got those clips in the box ready to roll?
I wanted you to look at this clip especially because it looked to me like you gave Nico your leg. You played like what is called a chess gambit. You said, here, take my rook, take my queen, but I'm going to win the game. I'm going to checkmate you. And what you did then was just dove right over him onto his leg, and you got the scramble. So let's watch that real quick, and then let's hear about it from you.
And he's got to win in a way he's not used to. He's got to win and grind it out.
Megaludis looking for the single leg.
This is where Delgado is tough. Both of these guys are good at the scramble. Guy keeps his head up, usually wins this.
Oh, it's
very close to a takedown. Very close right now.
Two.
There it is. 2 points for Delgado to take the lead.
And he's getting the count.
Bring us through, Jesse, you know, in that moment, kind of third period in that scramble, and only get two, you get back points. What's going through your mind? And tell us how you improvised and pulled that cradle off.
So it was 1-1, right? And kind of, I mean, Mark said, I could hear Mark yell, you know, move your feet. You know, I was already on top. So like kind of like, conceding that we're, you know, probably not going to be able to ride him, but I wrestled him so many times.
But in that particular scramble, it looked to me like you gave him your leg.
I think we both knew that it was going to be decided on our feet. Mark said, move your feet. So you kind of see there's a little bit of burst in that first couple seconds, moving my feet. I take a shot. And then we froze it there for a second, but you could see my feet are set. That's kind of my re-attack. Instead of down block re-attack, I forced him to go below my knee. And now he can go to an ankle. And he knew that. We wrestled, I think, 6 or 7 times in our careers. But it's kind of like your leg attack and my re-attack. And we'll see who scores. A lot of times I was getting stalemated. I did a pretty good job at Big Tens that year of getting to his legs. I beat him like 6-2 or something, but it was really, really controlled. Probably the best match I ever had against him. But that time he was shutting down my offense, doing a really good job. I was trying to time his step or time a reach or something, and he was doing a pretty good job of staying low. So that third period opened it up, and then that's where that came. I knew once I got the ankle, like, okay, this is my chance to score. And luckily it didn't get stalemated. Yeah, for the most part, the new danger rule would have benefited me. I guess that one, they would have started counting. But yeah. Well, now they were going to change the rule.
That was another question I had, because when I watch you, you never spent 3 seconds on your back, ever. It was always, you know, you're flipping from side to side, and then it was the other guy who was on his back because you gained the altitude, you gained the height advantage, and put them in danger.
Yeah. So I don't know. Of course, I'm biased, but I felt like anytime I got in one of those positions, the ref wasn't. Now they would count danger, but the ref was looking for a fall right away.
Yeah.
I wrestled Nico in the duel. I think it was that year, and they called a pin like boom, real quick, right away, with like a couple seconds left. Like, dang, okay, like I put myself in that position. But then Conrad had freaking David Taylor on his back for like 10 seconds. He was kicking his legs doing that one. And I'm like, dude, are you serious?
Like, was that at Penn State?
It was at Illinois too. It makes it even worse. Yeah.
Let's roll that second clip, Greg. Yeah, this right cradle, Jesse, is what I really want to talk about, right?
Like, at what point did you say,
hey, I'm
going to
cradle him up and get some back points? that's a limber leg, pretty unique cradle right there.
I remember because he's so flexible.
Yeah, he would do those splits.
Yeah, so right here, I knew, okay, here's a chance, my scoring opportunity, I got to take it. So I really attacked it. Yeah, once I got to it, I really tried to attack that position. You could see, like, I've did a cartwheel almost because I didn't know if, you know, any of those matches, those big matches against good guys, you don't know if you're going to get another opportunity. So, like, as soon as he touched my leg, exploded to it, like almost a cartwheel.
And that's that's why I said it looked to me, Jesse, like you gave him your leg. You said, here, take the bait. He took the bait, and then you went for it.
Well, yeah, so it's either there's a couple of things that can happen. So I led a really far left. So it was hard to get to my back leg because I led so hard left. And I was also really low. So if you're going to get to my leg, it was usually below the knee. So there's only a couple of things he could do there. So like I anticipated what he was going to, where he's going to go. There's only a couple of things you could do if you're going to get past my head hands. So he got past it. So my feet were set to roll already. Like my stance was just that way. And I knew once I got there, like that was my chance. So I rolled through, and then he was kind of in a splits position. Like the way I had the cradle was a little weird. I remember looking over to my corner, like, can I take it? Like, should I take it? And they kind of just looked back at me, and it seemed like forever, but the clip's like maybe how many seconds is that? Like one, if that?
Just a few, and
yeah. So right here, I remember locking it. You can look at my head.
It looks like you looked to see if they could score two.
There it is. I looked at them. They didn't do anything, and so I just took it back.
Oh, that's great.
I want to jump to you and Nashon Garrett, clip number three here. This is pretty amazing stuff.
Yeah, so this one was a little bit different. Oh, that was the second. That one I was ready for. The first one, it was like his range was like, I wrestled him like three times. So I kind of like had a feel for where they're attacking from, him and Nico. But that time he shot from a range I wasn't used to. Like he shot from really far, and he got in pretty deep. So it was kind of like here on this one, I knew where I was at. Like I kind of felt that one coming. My feet were set for that one. But on that first one, it was like,
yeah, it was right off the whistle.
Yeah, well, it was further than I was used to. Like for him, but even for anyone, like nobody's shooting from that far and getting that kind of pop. So when he got to it, it was kind of like, whew, like auto. It was auto flight or auto response. Like,
yeah,
like my body just went.
Well, I call this the greatest scramble in NCAA finals history. And it is, because what happened to your knees there is criminal, but you survived it. But also what you're doing right now, if you can see it on the screen, you're looking down, you see his foot, and then you're going to use your right leg to trap his foot and capture it. And I'll play that, and you can talk us through it. You trap his foot, and then you capture it.
Oh, yeah. Did a little block. I'll do that. There are sometimes I used to do that, or I would kick it out, too, so I could get height. So if I would have kicked it out, Then he would have went to that knee, and I could have used that leg to get up and drive back into him. I must have not felt like I could have done it, but I definitely would prefer to have both ankles like that.
Yeah, I didn't score here, did I? I recall this match. Nashon was constantly shooting on you. Even though he knew your defense was so good, he was attacking you the whole match, at least early on, correct, Jesse?
Yeah, with him, I usually didn't let him get to my leg. Like I said, that his range was further than I was used to. So, like, it kept messing me up. Like, I didn't feel like he could get to my legs, and he kept getting to it. And then, like, obviously, I was ready for it after the first one, but still, like, I wasn't expecting him to get to those legs. You can see a change in my stance, too. I'm a lot more intentional.
Yeah. So Jesse, real quick, too. Nico, Nashon, which one would you rather wrestle? or which one would you rather not wrestle?
Nico is such a pain to wrestle. He was, like, constantly on your head, constantly sweeping for ankles. He was hard to finish on. He was hard to ride. But so definitely for me, I would have preferred Nashon, but Nashon just had his number. Like, he would kill him.
Yeah. Well, the next clip is going to be from the Garrett match as well, and it's going to show you scoring the only takedown. And I think it's pretty cool because the announcers say that you were something like 7 or 8 takedowns to 0 versus him in your career, which is crazy.
Yeah, like I said, I felt like I had a pretty good feel on him. Yeah, here it is. So there I'm a little cautious. I'm like, how far can this guy shoot from? I finally got to it. And then it's kind of like I said in that first match, you don't know if you're going to get another chance, and I didn't here. So it's the utmost importance to get that takedown. I was just talking to one of the Brown kids the other day. It's like, If you get to a leg, you got to score because you don't know if you're getting back there.
Yeah.
That's a great point, especially with takedowns being 3.
Yeah, it's like, especially against a good guy, like you don't know if you're ever going to be able to get back to that leg.
And this is the final seconds. You're going to see your arms raised. A real short, brief shot of your parents. Unfortunately, I think Cornell people standing in their way.
Huh. We're going to relive some greatness for you here, Jesse. And that's the second NCAA title right there for Jesse Delgado. And there it is.
Hmm. There Jackson. We go, Mom and Pop.
That was my roommate, Jackson.
Well, let's move on to Matt McDonough.
Oh, yeah.
And this is from one of my favorite matches of all time. That's you against him at Iowa Carver Hawkeye Arena. And I always tell people, you beat him twice that day. You take him down multiple times in regulation, then this is overtime. Can you walk us through?
Yeah, you know, I had that ref at an open against Corey Clark, too, and he kind of did the same thing. I felt like I was going to win that match in overtime. You can just feel guys kind of fade. I think he probably had a hard weight cut, wasn't expecting a tough match. And it might have just kind of like you get an emotional dump when something like that happens. So I'm pretty sure I wasn't ranked at all when I went to that duel.
Yeah, this was where you were a redshirt freshman. He was a 2-time finalist, 1-time champ. You come into his home and you beat him in regulation. The ref says, no, I'm going to make it overtime.
Yeah, that was crazy.
Then you beat him again. I was so pissed and then so happy watching it.
Finish walking us through that one, and then we're going to turn to something else, another California kid I have to ask you about.
I felt pretty good. I remember feeling really excited to be there. I was always really nervous. I mean, I was still nervous. I was always nervous my whole career, but like in high school, like, you know, you feel those nerves to the point where it's not enjoyable. And that was probably one of the first times where I really enjoyed the moment leading up to it. It's Because you're finally there. Like, you're a little kid. You watch Iowa. You see the Iowa singlet on TV, and now you're wrestling on that stage, and you know you got fans booing and you and that kind of stuff. So it's something that, you know, most people probably don't ever get to experience. So it's a special thing, and I think that's probably, for me at least, I think that's the best arena to wrestle in. Penn State's pretty good too, but the fans are just so obnoxious. And it makes it better, I think.
Yeah, and there's 20,000 of them, right? So, yeah, well, you know, roll me into another question here. You know, coming from California, you and I spoke briefly prior to, and you paved the way for another California kid, you know, Isaiah Martinez. And I'd like to just kind of talk to you about, like, what, you know, from California to Illinois is a long way. You know, not many kids throughout West were making their way to the Big Ten, at least to Illinois at the time. You know, why did you decide to come to Illinois, and tell us how you convinced Isaiah to come too, and you paved his way?
Well, the reason I came was because Mark got the job. He was coaching at Cal Poly. I was okay. I was a California state champion. I placed at cadets at Fargo. I didn't place in junior, so I was okay. I wasn't in the top 100.
Wow.
Yeah, but I mean, I was okay. I wasn't great. So Mark was at Cal Poly, and that's kind of, for Cal Poly, that's a pretty good get, you know, state champion, two-time Fargo All-American in cadets, but still. And at that time, I might have been the most credentialed guy on the team. I don't know. I wasn't, no, Boris, because Boris and his brother were on the team. Yeah. And they had someone else too. They ended up having that group ended up being pretty good. They had some All Americans, but I got off track. But Mark was the coach there. He recruited me, and man, he's such a good motivator. Like when you hear him talk, you could see it in his eyes. Like, that's his passion. That's what his life's about. Mm-hmm. And I was originally committed to go to Maryland. I wanted to, I didn't really, you know, I wanted to go somewhere else. I wanted to try something new. I didn't really want to stay in California. You know, everybody lives their whole life and wherever they're from, but I wanted to go out and experience new things. So I wanted to try and go somewhere else. And then I talked to Mark, and it was just kind of like, you see that fire, that passion. For me, I wanted to be around that. That kind of energy and that kind of coach, and like the way he talked about wrestling. And then eventually when I got there, no one had ever talked to me like that. No one had ever told me like, you're going to be good. You're going to do this. You're made, like, he really like made me feel good about myself. And he really like, and not even just in general, like I'd never felt that confident before in myself ever in my life before I met Mark. So, I think I just felt that when I talked to him for the first time, and he didn't start to like make me feel that until I got into the room and he saw like how I worked and that kind of stuff. But I could definitely sense that passion from him. And we went to Junior Fila Nationals. That's basically UWW Junior Nationals. So I was sitting at the top, like, to make the junior world team, I would have had to wrestle a best of three. It would have been Mark Gray because he ended up representing the team, but the freaking transfer took us like 6 months. The AD wouldn't release me. And back, well, now they release it like nothing. You can get red shirts, eighth years, transfer to whatever school you want. But when I was in school, it was really hard to do all that. So he didn't want to release me. So I didn't get to go to the junior. I guess I still could have, but I just didn't go to the junior worlds. And then we finally got it. I flew out like pretty soon. I got there like the day before school started with just a bag. I didn't even take a recruiting trip or talk to any of the other, I might've talked to Huff once or twice, but I didn't really like have any relationship with any of the guys on the team, any of the coaches, nothing. I just wanted to be with Mark that bad.
Yeah. Well, I want to jump in real quick and tell you this, or ask you this: why did you let tiny little Imar beat you in high school.
He was good.
He was pretty good, but still, you're Jesse Delgado.
I beat him the first time, though. We're still 1-1. It's going to be like Rocky at the end of Rocky. What is that, three? Rocky well, four. We still have one more match.
There you go. Well, you know, we're not going to let Isaiah off the hook. We know you convinced them to come to Illinois, so take credit for that, Jesse.
I think, like, well, after that first year, we were really, like, we had a lot of momentum going. We got, what did we get? I think we got fourth at the national duels, but it was a big duel back then. Like, we barely lost to Oklahoma State because our heavyweight, I think he lost in overtime, actually. Our 97-pounder lost in overtime, and I think our heavyweight lost in overtime, too. And our 41, Daryl Thomas, was beating Josh Kindig, too, and he lost late. So we kind of, like, lost that one. But we would have been in the finals, and we would have had Minnesota, who we actually matched up okay with. Instead, we lost, and then we had to wrestle Iowa for third and fourth. And then we got kind of killed. But but still, we were a pretty good team. We beat Cornell to make it to the Final Four.
Yeah. Was that the year that Mario Gonzalez stepped in at heavyweight at Cornell?
Yeah, that was a really cool moment. So we bumped up, we put our backup 97 in, and then we put Mario at heavyweight, and that's what won us the duel.
Yeah, and well, that's so coincidental, because that's my second favorite regulation Illinois duel match. The first one, of course, is you beating McDonough in Carver Hawkeye. So that's very cool.
Hey, Jesse, you know, you were at Illinois, wrestled Illinois, kind of stepped away from Illinois, but now we have you back. We have you back in Champaign, and as the faithful would like to say, where you belong, right? Yeah. So tell us about a little bit how you got back, what you're doing, and then I have a great promotional idea for Jesse Delgado that I'm going to spurn on you at the end, right?
All right. So me and actually my other roommate, Jordan Blanton, he runs Relentless Training Center up north. He talked to me about, wanting to open a location down south. And we wanted to move back to Illinois or, somewhere in the Midwest, because it was a little bit. I mean, East Coast is so much different, right? I was at Brown. I loved it out there. The people are great. The people were so nice to me. And
It's Rhode Island.
Well, that's the thing about Rhode Island. It's like such a small state. So like some of the stuff's unorganized. Like the DMV, you can't get an appointment for like 2 months, and there's no one to talk to. So you have to do it all online. Just little stuff like that, because it's such a small state. But I loved it out there, man. The school, we had someone for everybody. Like you need a dentist, we got a guy. You need a chiropractor, we got a guy. Doctor, whatever you need, they got a guy. And they all want to help, so it's usually free. Top of that, just great people, really successful people, and I loved it. But
well, how many kids do you have at Relentless South now?
At Relentless South, we have it differs from day to day. We got a group of maybe like 15 kids that are consistently coming right now. We're hoping to pick that number up for this next session, retain some of those kids, and just keep the train going.
It's kind of an opportunity. I mean, if I were a parent, I would want my kids over there with you training versus just about anything else in the country, but certainly if I lived in the area.
Yeah, we marketed it a little bit late. So, but we get some drop-ins, and like I said, we expect to have a lot more kids for this freestyle session coming up. We're going to have a March session, just kind of like an in-between off-season and freestyle. And then April, we're going to start up for freestyle. So we expect to have a good amount of kids for that. And then, like I said, just keep plugging away.
Yeah, we're going to get Jordan Blanton on sometime, but we have to earmark about 2 hours for JB, right? JB can talk. So Jesse, real quick, how long did JB talk to you to convince you to come back? I know it was a conversation, you know, and Jordan, he's relentless, right?
I'm not sure exactly. But it was something we were interested in. Like, I just love Champaign. I don't know. Maybe it's just like, it's a comfort thing, but, I love the town. I love it. It's small. You can get anywhere you need to go. I know all the places. Just, I mean, I'm originally from California, but the hometown I grew up in, I went to a different high school. So I lived in one city until I was, 13? And then I moved to another one. I went to move to Gilroy for high school. And then I moved to Cal Poly. So I don't really have... I have like one or two family members in Salinas where I'm from originally. Most of my friends from Gilroy are in San Jose or, you know, just wherever they moved. So it's not like here where it's kind of like the core group of people are still here that I knew. But even if they weren't, I still love Champaign. Like, I don't know how to explain it besides just, you know, home is home. So I like it. I don't know.
Well, Champaign and the Fighting Illini, you know, are glad you're back home and you know, doing the things you're doing for Relentless Training. But I have a great idea for you and Jordan Bland, right? But I'm going to have to take some credit for it at some point. But, you know, Mike Ironman's made a living off scramble camp. There's no better person in the world to do a scramble camp. Go around and get people to come in and host a scramble camp and do it all over Illinois to get kids to come than Jesse Delgado. Jesse Delgado should start his own scramble camps, his own little sessions, and he should be doing it around the state of Illinois and get kids to track to Champaign. That's my idea, Jesse.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea. I mean, that's we wanted to start doing something like that where we're like going around and kind of like not necessarily, I mean, scramble camp's a great idea. I might just do that one for myself.
Yeah, well, you know what? We want to do that
for Relentless, where it's kind of like we're going out there, like, I don't know, like maybe me and Jordan or just me or me and Prater or whoever, and like we're going to these different places and kind of even like just doing free clinics, you know, free camps, just so they we can get our name out there and they can kind of see like, okay, this is what we have to offer. If you like it, then, you know, come down. If you don't, then...
Well, I'm going to throw out, you're more than welcome to host the first one at Lockport. I'll get with Oster. We'll host the first one at Lockport. We'll get the Jesse Delgado scramble camp going.
Yeah.
We'll get your name out there, Jesse. We'll help you out. It's been a pleasure to have you on the show. Really appreciate your time. You know, we went one-time national champ with Marinetti. We stepped it up our game with Jesse Delgado, two-time national champ, back home in Champaign. Any final words, Greg, before we kick it off here?
Well, it's a pleasure, Jesse. I love to talk to you.
Yep. Yeah.
No, Jesse, before we let you go, we need to hear it. Threeee is the new two podcast. Give us that three, Jesse.
Nah, that's not even how it goes. Two, three. That's how it goes.
That's the best way to do it. Folks, Jesse Delgado, awesome man. Check him out at Relentless Training South. Check out Jordan Bland up at Relentless Training North. But Jesse, like I said, we're going to sign off here. But welcome back home to Champaign. And we're not going to let you go anywhere anytime soon, buddy.
Thanks.
Take care, guys.
Something. Come here. Yeah. Mommy, can we go in there? Joe, no, come with Mommy. Come on. Good.
Okay.
Let's go.
Dad duty.